Y'all glad to be here this morning? Amen. It's good to see everybody. Thank you so much for being here. And I see we got some first-time visitors. Thank you for being here this morning. Welcome to Promised Land. It is a good day in the house of the Lord. And as far as I'm concerned, any day we can come here and worship Jesus Christ, it's a blessing. And so we've got a big week ahead. We've got church camp. And I know we've got right at 70 going to camp this week, and so y'all be in prayer for them. They will be leaving at 7 o'clock. You be here at 6:30 in the morning to get loaded up, and then we'll take off to camp. Also this week, the lowest circle meeting will be Tuesday at 2 p.m., and then there will be no fun in the sun or youth this week because of camp. Next Sunday night, there'll be the snack the Sunday night after church at the Carter home. So y'all be sure this is for the teenagers. Y'all be sure to be a part of this. Fifth Sunday is this month. We've got fellowship and got all kinds of announcements in here. I did want to announce Miss Bonnie Matthews, one of our dear ladies in our church, went home to be with the Lord last night. And you say, well, who was Miss Bonnie? If you ever walked in the foyer, you saw a lady sitting at the desk right behind that peppermint bowl, and that was Miss Bonnie Matthews. And I'm thankful today that she's with the Lord. I'm thankful today for the promises that we have. Pray for Brother Mike and that family. Also, the Miss Nancy Hennington family, remember them. A lot going on, but I'm glad we have a big God that can handle all of these things. Amen. Are y'all ready to worship this morning? Amen. He's worthy, isn't he? Amen. He's worthy. He's good even when we're not. He's faithful when we're not. God's been good to us. Amen. And so let's worship him in spirit and in truth. Me and you come, and we'll prepare to take up this morning's offering. And remember the campers in your prayers and all these families in your prayers. And I'm going to ask Brother Alex if you would open us up in a word of prayer, please.
Those who have been checking on my dad. His surgery went very well on Friday. And we're just thankful to the Lord for all of that. And he is doing well. May get to go home tomorrow. So he's doing really good. Having a little more pain this morning, but it's day three, so it's kind of expected. So thank you for praying for him. If you texted or called me on Friday, I'm sorry. My phone screen busted, and I could hear it doing stuff, but I couldn't do anything with it, and so I apologize for not getting back with you, but thank you for checking on him. The Lord is good. Amen. Let's go. Good deal. Man, we've just been rolling with that the last couple of weeks. With mission trip and vacation Bible school. I can't wait for camp. Man, it's going to be good. Stand with me this morning as we sing. Save, save, save. I found a friend who is all to me. Today, tell them your name. Thank you. Thank you, and you may be seated. This morning, Jesus saves.
We have heard about Jesus saves, Jesus saves, all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves, every land, from the sea.
words today. Beautiful. This next verse, come, Nanny. Oh, what a friend is Jesus. Sure anchor for my soul. Man, that's good stuff to sing. I'm going to sing it. Oh, what a friend. You may be seated this morning. Several months ago, I heard a sermon that brought this song to mind for me, and I haven't been able to let go of it since then. I took some time to study the scripture from where it came and find out the situation. And, you know, a lot of times that's helpful in scripture if you back up a little bit, go past a little bit. Context means a lot. But I'm just going to read this one scripture to you today. But the scripture that goes with this song is found in the book of Galatians chapter 2 and in verse 20. And this is Paul speaking. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. We've sang all morning about salvation and being saved, and we just finished up with how God keeps us, hide thou me, protects us, watches after us, walks with us each and every day. I don't know if you understand this or not. I'm sure you do. But when you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, your life no longer belongs to you.
That's right.
I am crucified with Christ.
That's right.
I don't live. He does. He lives, not me. Think about that. Think about the priorities you put in your life. Think about all aspects of your life. Who's making those decisions? The one that you live for? Yes. Are you living for him? Are you living for you? Who lives? He should live. I died. He lives. I'm crucified with Christ. Okay.
When I look back at what I thought was living, I'm amazed at the price I chose to pay. And to think that I ignored what really mattered, 'cause I thought the sacrifice would be too great. When I finally reached the point of giving in, I found the cross was calling even then. And even though it took dying to survive, I never felt so much alive. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. Not I, but Christ that lives within me. His cross will never ask for more than I can give. For it's not my strength, but His. There's no greater sacrifice. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. As I hear the Savior call for daily dying, I will bow beneath the weight of Calvary. Let my hands surrender to His piercing purpose that holds me to the cross, yet sets me free. I will glory in the power of the cross. The things I thought were gain, I count as loss. And with this suffering I identify. And by His resurrection power, I am alive. For crucified with Christ, and yet I live. Not I, but Christ that lives within me. His cross will never ask for more than I can give. For it's not my strength, but His. There's no greater sacrifice. Christ, and yet I live. I will offer all I have so that His cross is not in vain. For I'm bound to live is Christ, and to die is truly.
Because we are crucified with Christ, we are no longer slaves to the sin of this world. You are free. Free. today because of what he did on a cross for you. Will you stand with me as we sing?
You unravel me with a melody, and you surround me with a song. On your
just praise you today for who you are, for what you've done, and for what we know that you're going to do. Father, use this service today, first of all, to bring honor and glory to you, because you are above all. Father, today it's also my prayer that you would lead the lost, that your Holy Spirit would convict those here today who may not know Jesus Christ as their Savior. Father, use our pastor today as he stands before us. Give him the things that he stands in need of, Father. Use him in a mighty and a powerful way. Fill him with your Spirit. And Father, help us to hear, not just with our ears, but with our hearts. And Father, to live, not just in this place, but in every place, that we are your children. That we are crucified with Christ, and it is no longer our lives that we live, but it's your life through Jesus Christ. We love you. We praise you. And it's in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.
Amen. Remain standing. Grab your Bibles. Look with me in Zechariah chapter 14. The Old Testament book of Zechariah, it is the last, second to last book of the Old Testament there in the very back of the Old Testament. We have gone through a study in the book of Zechariah for some time on Wednesday nights, and I've not been able to be here on Wednesday nights, or we've had other things going. I was going to finish it this past week. We had a missionary come in, and the Lord just convicted me to preach this morning. Zechariah chapter 14. Zechariah chapter 14. We will begin our reading in verse 1. Zechariah 14 and in verse 1. Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and thy spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee. For I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle, and the city shall be taken, and the houses rifled, and the women ravished, and half the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off from the city. Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations as when he fought in the day of battle. And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great valley, and half of the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south. And ye shall flee to the valley of the mountains. For the valley of the mountains shall reach unto Azel. Yea, ye shall flee like as ye fled from before the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. And the Lord my God shall come, and all the saints with thee. And it shall come to pass in that day that the light shall not be clear nor dark, but it shall be one day which shall be known to the Lord, not day nor night, but it shall come to pass that at the evening time it shall be light. And it shall be in that day that living waters shall go out from Jerusalem, half of them toward the former sea, and half of them toward the hinder sea. In summer and in winter shall it be. And the Lord shall be king over all the earth. In that day there shall be one Lord, and his name one. You may be seated. I want you to look there in verse 1. The Bible said, behold, the day of the Lord cometh. I want to speak to you on the subject this morning, the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord. The day of the Lord speaks of a particular and singular day in which the sovereign will of God will be accomplished on earth. If you remember during his earthly ministry, Jesus prayed, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Well, the day of the Lord is the fulfillment of God's perfect and sovereign will for this curse-stricken world. Understand, the day of the Lord will come. It will come by the sovereign, perfect will of God. And that is when the will of God will be accomplished on planet Earth. This will be the second coming of Jesus Christ. The day of the Lord, this phrase has been used by 8 different Old Testament prophets. It was used by 4 different New Testament writers there, the apostles. It was has been preached for thousands and thousands and thousands of years that the Lord is coming again, that the day of the Lord is coming. When the Old Testament prophets spoke of this day, they spoke of this day with a sense of imminence, nearness, and expectation. They preached about it, they talked about it like the day would come during their day, like they would experience the coming of the Lord. For thousands of years, prophets had preached that Jesus was coming again. He was coming again, and they preached it with so much passion. They preached it with so much heart and conviction that you literally believed that the Lord was going to come back in their day. And they preached like he was coming back in their day. Matter of fact, Ezekiel said, for the day is near, even the day of the Lord is near. Even the prophet Joel said, for the Lord is coming, it is close at hand. And so for thousands of years, preachers have preached the day of the Lord is at hand, it's coming. And we've preached and we've preached, and I'm thankful today that there's still preachers that stand and say, the day of the Lord is near, it's coming. Jesus is coming. The day of the Lord will come upon us one day. We will not all be expecting that day. It will come like a thief in the night. It will come in a moment of a twinkling of an eye when we're not expecting it, when we're not watching, when we're not waiting, when we're not listening. The day of the Lord will be upon humanity. And this event will change humanity as we know it. The world will never be the same again. The greatest event that this earth has ever experienced is the coming of a Savior. That a baby was born in Bethlehem. Well, friend, one day the Lion of the tribe of Judah will come. And it will be the greatest event that this earth has ever experienced. It will get everyone's attention. Everyone will know that He has come. Everyone will experience it some way, somehow. But the entire world will know that the day of the Lord is at hand. The day of the Lord is at hand. This day has been carved in stone. It has been etched in the parchment of history. It has been gloriously written in red by the Lord Himself. There is nothing you can do to reverse the fact that the day of the Lord cometh. The day of the Lord cometh. I don't believe, preacher, but still, the day of the Lord cometh. Your unbelief will not change the fact that the day of the Lord cometh. The day of the Lord cometh. Well, there's a lot of people that they preach something different. The Bible says the day of the Lord cometh. It's coming, and He's coming soon. It's coming soon. The day of the Lord reveals four things, and I won't preach all these this morning. But the day of the Lord reveals four things. Number one, the King will come. Number two, the King will gather. Number three, the King will stand. And number four, the King will reign. I want you to notice, number one, the King will come. It says there in verse 1, behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and thy spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee. The King will come. And here's something we know about the King coming. We know that He's coming. We know as His believers that He's coming. We know that He's coming. In fact, the Apostle Paul said, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. And I love how he told the believers there, you know perfectly that the Lord is coming. There is something with the heart of the believer that we know that Jesus is coming again. Because when you receive His salvation, you know that He is a promise-keeping God. And we know that He is coming. It amazes me, the world that don't even believe in Him. The world that says, oh, He's not coming. They make movie after movie after movie about this great event that's going to end the entire world. In their hearts and in their minds, they know something is coming. Earth proclaims that something's coming. Creation is groaning. Something is coming. We cannot sustain ourselves in the route in which we're going. Something's got to be coming. And the reality of it is, God's people rejoice. God's people shout. God's people praise. And the fact in our hearts, we know that He's coming. The world says no. And God's people says, He's coming. He's coming. There's something in our hearts. We anticipate it. We know that our Lord and Savior is coming. I kind of feel about like this. If He can do it the first time, bless God, He can do it the second time. If He can defeat death, hell, and the grave, then He can come again. And in our hearts, we know that the King is coming. We know that He's coming, but we also know how He's coming. We know how He's coming. When He ascended from the Mount of Olives, you know the angels there said that this same Jesus that was taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as ye have seen Him go into heaven. And so this reveals that the coming of the Lord will be a bodily return. We know that it will be a visible return, and we know that it will be a dynamic return. We know how He's coming. He's coming in a manner that every eye will see Him and well because of Him. We know that He's coming in a manner that will be a dynamic event that will catch the attention of the entire world. In fact, we know that He's coming for a battle. And in this battle, there is such a dynamic appearance here of our Lord and Savior. I got to read to you what John said. He said, I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire. Boy, this don't look like the baby born in Bethlehem, does it? His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. He was clothed with a vesture, dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies, he's coming, and he's coming with an army. Listen to me now. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. I wonder who the armies are. Y'all didn't hear that. I wonder who's in that army. If you're born again, you're in that army. And we'll have our white robes, and we'll be riding with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And the Bible says, and out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He came as a lamb the first time, but he's coming as a lion the next time. He came with gentleness the first time, but he's coming with fierceness the next time. And all the world will know that he has come. We know he's coming. We know how he's coming, and we know why he's coming. I want you to look in our text. Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and thy spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee. For I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle, and the city shall be taken, and the houses rifled, and the women ravished. And half the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off from the city. Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations when he fought in the day of battle. He's coming for three purposes. Number one, to restore Israel physically. He will come to restore them physically. Notice how he comes in just in time to save the nation of Israel. And he will restore them physically. Now hold your place there and go to Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11. You say, preacher, when Jesus comes back, why will he come and restore the nation of Israel physically? Because God is a covenant-keeping God. And he made a promise that he would restore them. The end times calls it the fullness of the Gentiles. Our time as a Gentile will run its course. When Jesus comes the second time, this is not about the Gentiles as much as it is the nation of Israel. Because Jesus will come and restore them physically. Now, I want you to look in Romans 11, verse 26. And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written. There shall come out of Zion the Deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. So not only will he restore them physically, but number two, he's coming to restore them spiritually. Right now, the nation of Israel have ears that they cannot hear. They have eyes that they cannot see. They do not understand as a whole that Jesus is the Savior of the world. But when he comes again, they will understand it, and they will see him for the one they pierced, is what the Bible says. And he will deliver them from their sins. For what purpose? In verse 27, for this is my covenant unto them. So he's coming to restore them physically, spiritually. But now I want you to go to Isaiah chapter 2. Are y'all still with me? I want you to stay awake. Y'all didn't hear me. I want y'all to stay awake. I want y'all to listen. And I promise, and we've got a few scriptures to go through, and I promise I won't keep you any later than normal, but I want you to listen to all of these things, because the day of the Lord is a very important day. It is a day that planet Earth will be changed forever. The Lord will come to restore Israel physically, spiritually, but he will come to execute judgment on sin. Isaiah chapter 2 and in verse 17. And the loftiness of man shall be bowed down, and the haughtiness of men shall be made low. And the Lord alone shall be exalted in that day. So what's this day for? For the loftiness of man to be bowed down, the haughtiness of men shall be made low, and the Lord alone shall be exalted in that day. And the idols he shall utterly abolish. Do you notice the first two things to go when it comes to the wicked is the pride, their pride, and their idols? Do you realize that the day of the Lord is coming because of our pride and because of our idols? And when he comes, the day of the Lord will come to execute judgment upon sin. God will judge all sin. All sin will be judged and dealt with. The pride of man will be gone. The idols of man will be destroyed. That's what's going to happen when Jesus comes again. The Lord's coming. The King is coming. Not only will the King come, but the King will gather. Go to verse 2. Are y'all still with me? I want you to stay with me. I'm going somewhere with all this. Zechariah 14, verse 2. And he said, "For I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle." Go to verse 3. "Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against all those nations as when he fought in the day of battle." All nations will gather in around the city of Jerusalem to fight what they think against the nation of Israel. But ultimately, they are there for the battle of Armageddon. All nations. Did y'all hear that? And you say, "Preacher, America is friends with Israel." The Bible says all nations. According to the Bible, Israel will not have a friend but Jesus Christ. There will not be one nation on their side. You say, "Brother Josh, what in the world?" Surely America, 20 years ago, we couldn't even fathom the thought that America wouldn't stand with Israel. But today, we can see it coming. Today, we can grasp the concept that this nation could easily turn its back on the nation of Israel. So one of two things about America here, either America is not friends with Israel anymore, or America is not here anymore. But the Bible says that all nations, and so the Lord will gather all nations into one place in the nation of Israel, there at the city of Jerusalem. Now all nations will be lured to Jerusalem by the Lord through their commitment to the Antichrist. Now y'all still with me? Hold your finger there in Zechariah, and I want you to go to Revelation 16. All nations will go to this piece of property, and they will fight against the Lord. How in the world do you get all the nations in the entire world to gather in one little piece of property? I can't even comprehend that. I can't even understand that. But I want you to notice what it says in Revelation chapter 16 and in verse 13. And I want you to just keep your place in Revelation, because we're going to look back here again in a minute. Look in verse 13. "And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth into the kings of the earth and the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon." So he is gathering them there for a battle. He gathers them there because these frogs come out of the mouth of the beast and the false prophet and the devil, and they go out to seduce through wonders and signs and miracles these people into believing this lie. Now understand, they are gathered here in this piece of property for two reasons. Number one, their hatred for God and Israel. And number two, because they have been deceived. They have been deceived. Why? Because these spirits are going out, the spirits of devils, going out to deceive the nations. And you say, "Preacher, that's not fair." You understand this. Before they were deceived, they had an opportunity to receive Christ. and they rejected Jesus as their Savior. The Lord turned them over to a reprobate mind, and then they turned the truth into a lie, and they rather believe a lie than the truth. And so these nations that gathered there had an opportunity to be saved, but they rejected Jesus, and now they have been deceived. How have they been deceived? By miracles, signs, and wonders. Now, when I look on Facebook and I scroll through the videos, you know they're listening to you and they're watching you. They know what you like. They follow your browser history and all of that. So all my videos is either on preaching or fishing. That's bad, isn't it? They're all on preaching or fishing. And all these preaching videos, half or three quarters, are charismatic preachers. And it is amazing the push that the charismatics have made in the last 10 years. That people are so hungry for a sign or a wonder. And there's always videos of these men casting out demons out of people. Let me tell you something, folks. There's nobody on earth that has the power or authority to cast a demon out of a man. And this is what amazes me about this. It's arrogant to say that I can take a demon out, but it's more arrogant to say that I can put the Spirit of God in you. Now, I can believe more that you can get a demon out, but you don't have the power or the authority to put the Spirit of God in a man. And so all of these miracles and wonders, it has people by the thousands and hundreds of thousands and millions, and they follow. Why? Because this is awesome. This is something we've never seen before. And the entire world will be deceived by it. The entire world will be lured by it. And can I tell you that in the last days, these lost people will follow a religion. But it's a false religion. It's an antichrist religion. It's not a true religion. It's a sense of godliness, but it lacks the power thereof. Can I tell you, I don't want to counterfeit Christianity. I don't want to be a part of a false religion. I want to be a part of the truth. I don't want to be deceived. And the only way to be set free is by the power of the truth. Isn't the Lord good? How, preacher, are all these nations going to gather? They're going to be deceived. Have you watched the news lately? What's wrong with them, preacher? They're deceived. Have they lost their minds? They sure have. Can I be honest? I can't even watch the news anymore. I don't understand half of what they're saying. It doesn't make a lick of sense because they believed a lie. Don't you get on board. You stick to the truth. Don't be deceived. You stick to the truth of God's Word. Because here's the bad news. It's going to get worse before it gets better. But He's going to gather. I want you to notice that also the King will stand. Hold your place there in Revelation, but look in Zechariah. Zechariah 14, verse 4. The King will come, the King will gather, and the King will stand. And His feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great valley, and half the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south. And ye shall flee to the valley of the mountains, for the valley of the mountains shall reach unto Azel. Yea, ye shall flee like as ye fled from before the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. And the Lord my God shall come and all the saints with thee. So the King will come, the King will gather, and the King will stand. When Jesus stands on the Mount of Olives, that's where He's going. He's going to the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives is a mountain just east of the old city of David. Just east of the gate of the old city, there's the Kidron Valley. And then just east of the Kidron Valley, there is the Mount of Olives. Remember that Jesus went through the Kidron Valley into the Garden of Gethsemane that is at the base of the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives is where Jesus left this earth. The Mount of Olives is where Jesus will return. And the Bible said that He will stand. And when He stands, the earth will be moved. And it will be shaken. And the Bible says here that it will be shaken in such a manner
that all the geography of that land and of the entire earth will be changed. And it will move. And I want you to notice what the scripture says. It is moved so that his people can escape. It is moved that the nation of Israel can get out of the city of Jerusalem. Now this is what Isaiah said. And a highway shall be there in a way. And it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over, but it shall be before those. The wafering men, though full, shall not err therein. So he will move all of this to let his people out into a place of safety. Now, the way has been narrow. Brother Allen, it looks kind of broad now. He moves everything so that the way becomes a broad way. And his children escape and get away from wrath, and they get out of there. But I want you to notice what it says here in verse 5. And ye shall flee to the valley of the mountains, for the valley of the mountains shall reach unto Azazel. Yea, ye shall flee, like as ye fled from before the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. Now, you still got your place there in Revelation. Look there in Revelation 16, verse 17, the seventh vial. There are 21 judgments. There are 21 judgments during the days of tribulation. Pretty much 20 of them will be in the last 3.5 years. 21 is the number of wickedness, rebellion, and sin. 13 is close to 21 in its meaning. 13 symbolizes depravity and sinfulness. 21 is an outgrowth of 13. 13 represents sinfulness. And if you make 21 out of 13, you got to have 8. So 13 means sinfulness. 8 means a new beginning. 21 represents wickedness at its ultimate level that produces a new beginning. On the 21st day of the month Nisan, on the 21st day of all the plagues of Egypt, is when the Lord destroyed the nation of Egypt and Pharaoh and its army. All of those days the Lord had got their attention and got their attention. On the 21st day is when they were destroyed. They got into the promised land. He said, go to a land with flowing with milk and honey. What happened? They rebelled against the Lord. Do you know how many times they rebelled against the Lord? 21 times in the Bible you find that the nation of Israel rebelled against the Lord. That's why they wandered for 40 years. That's why most of those people never made it to the promised land. A lot of those kids that left Egypt did not make it to the promised land with mom and daddy. Because sin can run its course in such a manner that it produces a new beginning. Sin creates new beginning. And in this judgment, God will cast out 21 judgments. Go to verse 17. I know I'm preaching past my time, but will you bear with me, please? I don't do this to you very often, but please stay with me. And the seventh angel poured out of his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, it is done. It is done. And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake such as what was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. Does that voices, thunders, and lightnings mean anything to you? Go back to the book of Exodus and you remember that when the law was given. But notice the lightning and the thunders is like it's never been heard before. This is something the world has never seen before. And then an earthquake that is so mighty and so great. It says in verse 19, and the great city was divided into three parts. I believe the great city is the city of Jerusalem. What divided it? Jesus standing on the Mount of Olives. When Jesus stood and stood on the Mount of Olives, it shook the entire earth. That everything was changed. Not only was there a way for his people to get out, but it changed everything and will change everything on planet earth. Notice what it said in verse 20. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. Everything is changed. Everything. Go back to verse 19. And the great city was divided in three parts. and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon came in remembrance before God to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of His wrath. His stand will destroy the cities of the earth. Every city will be destroyed, and there'll be one city standing, and that is the city of Jerusalem. And He will rebuild the city of Jerusalem to become what we know, the New Jerusalem. He will stand and He will shake. I don't really think we're ready for what's coming. We got our mind more in Facebook than we do the book. Jesus is coming. And when He comes, He will shake. He will shake the world like it's never been shaken before. And we as God's people think, is anything going to get their attention? Yes, sir, it is. The day of the Lord's coming. And the King is coming. And the King will gather. And the King will stand. And He will have the attention of the entire world. What a shaking. He's going to shake the universe. Hebrews, and I'm done. Brother Paul, come on. Hebrews chapter 12. You say, preacher, you scared me half to death this morning. Well, amen. I didn't do it to scare you. I did it to warn you. The day of the Lord is coming. The day of the Lord's upon us. We're more in love with baseball. We're more in love with deer hunting. We're more in love with, y'all done got quiet on me. We're more in love with fishing. We're more in love with our families. We're more in love with our idols than we are the Lord. But there's coming a shaking. We're so busy we don't have time for Him, but there's coming a shaking. We're so busy that we don't read our Bibles like we're supposed to, but there's coming a shaking. And all, remember what goes first, pride. Remember what goes second. Idols. Praise the Lord. It'll be destroyed. But notice Hebrews. Chapter 12. And in verse 25. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh. For if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape. If we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth? But now he hath promised, would you listen, saying once more, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made. If it can be shaken, it's going to be shaken. And it's going to be gone. But He ain't done. That those things which cannot be shaken may remain. What are we in a Presbyterian church this morning? Did y'all not see the scripture? The Bible says right here that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. I'm going to lose my boat. I'm going to lose my idols. There won't be another ball game to play. There won't be another fish to catch. I know men, y'all want crappie in heaven so bad, but good grief. All that stuff's going to be shaken. Only those things that are found in Him will stand firm. And all the things of the world will be destroyed and done away with. But it is those things that cannot be shaken that will remain. And you listen to me. If you will place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, nothing can shake your faith in Jesus. Not because of how great your belief is, but because of how great your God is. And there is nothing that can shake Him. There's not a country, there's not a nation, there's not a king, there's not a president that has the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. Church, wake up. Get excited.
The King is coming. I'm sitting here shouting that there's coming a day, that the Lord is coming. And if you don't get shaken now, one day you're going to be shaken to your core. And we got to get shaken over the Lord is coming again. He's coming again. The last time I got up there, I got so afraid because I thought my mama was going to whoop me. I said, Lord, if she watches that video, she said, son, you got to get their attention somehow because there's coming a shaking. And Jesus is coming again. And everything we know is going to be changed and different. Our families won't be the same. Our schools won't be the same. You think you've experienced change in the last 10 years, you ain't seen nothing. There's coming a shaking. There's coming a shaking. But Lane Cup, there's got to be. There's got to be. We can't keep going like this. Our families can't keep going like this. There's got to be a shaking. Hey. I want to get fired up because this is just a rehearsal for what's coming. He's coming. The day of the Lord coming. Whew. I feel like preaching this morning. Man, isn't the Lord good? He's coming. And bless God, He's coming for me. Daddy, mama, He's coming. Son, daughter, He's coming. He's coming. Are you ready? He's coming. He's coming to gather. He's coming to stand. He's coming. He's coming. If you're not ready for it, would you be saved today? Child of God, this ought to humble us before the throne of God to prepare for His coming. He's coming. I don't ever preach past 12 o'clock, regardless of what half of you say. But dadgum, who cares? Is this not the most important hour of our week? Where has time gone when this has been put at the end of the week? And if I have time, I'll get to it. If I have nothing else, I get to it. Boy, would we just fall back in love with Him this morning. Whew, what a Savior. Man, what a Savior. He saved me and I ain't been the same. Brother Paul, you might as well start singing because I ain't going to shut up. Y'all stand up. Man, I'm so fired up. You need to get saved. You need to give your heart to Jesus. These altars are open. These altars are open. If you need to make a decision, you come. If you need to be saved, come. Come on.